Hello, everyone, and welcome back to another episode of Mormon Stories Podcast. I'm your host, John DeLynn. It is August 23rd, 2019, and we are live streaming today to you from our Mormon Stories Podcast studios in Salt Lake City. And we're excited to be continuing our series on navigating Brigham Young University, or BYU, as an unorthodox or as a non-believing student. It's a really important topic. It causes a lot of heartache, as we learned from our episode that we just recorded with the Butters. It can be associated with depression and a lot of pain and suffering because, as we know, BYU is wonderful. We love BYU, but also it's a very painful place to kind of fall outside the norm and particularly to lose your faith. So we're doing a multi-part series where we're going to be doing three different interviews of sets of BYU students, and then we're going to end with a panel talking about this amazing resource called the BYU Survival Guide that we want to make sure everyone knows about, so that if you're a BYU student and you've lost your faith, or for any other reason need support outside of kind of orthodox channels, you can have that. So today now for part two of this interview, we are interviewing Jared Brinton. And the Brinton name is near dear to my heart because Janelle Brinton, who turns out to be Jared's older sister, she was a Mormon Stories listener from very early on. And I think I met her in Houston after she had left BYU and moved down there. And now she's finishing up her degree to be a therapist. But a shout out to Janelle, who is a good friend. And we're here to interview Jared. So Jared was a BYU student until recently, where he graduated. And he was a really important part of creating what has become the BYU Survival Guide and being a part of the support groups that are now hopefully flourishing throughout not just BYU Provo, but BYU Idaho, Hawaii, and maybe even, you know, there needs to be some resources at Southern Utah University and LDS Business College. But without any further ado, Jared Brinton, welcome to Mormon Stories Podcast.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. So,
yeah, so tell us your story. Like, now, you know, give us a little background before your BYU time so we can kind of know, you can establish your Mormon cred before you then, you know.
Yeah, it's so cliche. You have to go through and say, like, oh, well, I was such a devout Mormon.
Pioneer ancestors, yep, yep, and blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, I think what really makes my story unique is I had my faith transition while I was on a mission, and I went ahead and I finished the full 2 years as an agnostic, unbelieving member.
Okay, wait, are you going to skip your childhood? Or
no, like, I'm going to go there first, for sure. Okay. Just point in context. So let's go to the beginning for sure. So I'm the youngest of five children total. I was raised in the San Francisco Bay Area in the East Bay.
Oh, wow. What were parents doing there?
So my dad moved there for work as a doctor. He's an ophthalmologist, an eye doctor.
Okay.
Yeah. Also, my mom had some roots there because her family moved there for medical school when she was 12. So we have a lot of ties there, but my mom's from Idaho, my dad's from Utah, the whole pioneer stock, yada, yada. So yeah, youngest of five. Growing up, I was absolutely fully into the church. Like, I don't know, deacon's quorum president, teacher's quorum president, Eagle Scout, that sort of thing. I remember this memory of youth conference, and I ended up getting pulled up to the stand for the main speaker as one of a couple people, and he asked us if we had any scriptures memorized, and I went ahead and I recited half of the Psalm of Nephi. It's like 10, 20 verses just from memory. Like, I was that guy. So yeah, I was fully in, didn't really doubt it. I'd read the Book of Mormon half a dozen times before I ended up on my mission. All of this is so cliche. This is how everyone starts this sort of thing. But it gives some context. Another thing that gives some context is that I did a lot of debate growing up. I was part of debate clubs. I took speech and debate classes in high school at the local community college. Funny story, the teacher who was hosting our debate club decided to stop posting it. And me and my team were like, well, we want to keep on doing this. So we ended up doing it on the side, prepping for the next debate tournament. And we ended up going and we got like half a dozen medals. And it was like one of this really great experience because we kind of turned it into our hobby instead of just a thing we do at school. So we put a lot of time and effort into it. And that really informs the way that I think going through things. I have no issue with taking a side of an argument that I don't believe in and arguing it for the sake of getting some better understanding around an issue in general. I'm kind of removing the emotion from that so no one's getting offended sort of thing. That's I really like to have those sorts of conversations. And that ended up definitely informing my own faith transition going forward. My parents were very Orthodox Mormons. My mom's version of Mormonism, the way I would best describe it is, so she grew up in a very tiny farming town in Idaho. And then when she was 12, her family moved to inner city Oakland. Last time I checked, this is the third most violent city in the nation. So this was a huge culture shock for
Oakland.
Her. Yes, Oakland.
Yeah.
And she was fearing for her life on the daily. And what she ended up doing to cope was going full head on into the church. So the sort of Mormonism that I got from her was the world out there is a really scary place. And you need to be 100% obedient to the church in order to stay safe, sort of thing. That was kind of her version as I got it from her. And then my dad's was more of a, like, his family were, I think, the very successful people in Utah in general. Lots of, like, doctors, mission presidents, bishops. My grandpa's photo is hanging up in the University of Utah for contributions there. So from his perspective, I think he saw Mormonism as a way of life that has worked very, very well for his family. It has brought prosperity, it brought opportunities to contribute to society. And I think he saw Mormonism as the vehicle that allowed him to take these things that he really valued and pass it on to his children. So from his perspective, he also really valued having a very Orthodox Mormon home. The trouble, I guess, started around the time I was 8 or 9. My sister was in college at BYU at the time, and she started having doubts about the church. And this was back in, this would be 2003, 2004. This was like before people really left the church in any measurable numbers. So this was very kind of unusual. People hadn't really figured out yet, how do you interact with family members who have left the church? And it really did not go over well at all. My family did not react well to her.
Is this Janelle?
This is Janelle, yes.
I'm pretty sure I met her around 2011, 2012.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Yeah. So she had been out of the church for a good 7 years or so before that. I remember my mom had told a member of the family that she had reported Janelle to the honor code office for some infraction and that she wanted her to get expelled. And this was because, like, she knew that Janelle was doubting at this point and wanted to try and fix this because that was a huge issue. Didn't go over so well. She ended up getting put on academic probation. She didn't get expelled. A bunch of other drama in the family ended up having her be disowned from the family. She was, or as my parents would put it, she was disinvited from coming home. That was for about a decade. After a while, they started allowing her back. And the reasons that they put was basically, from their perspective, Janelle was being deceived by Satan. She was this really negative influence. Like, oh, she comes home and we smell alcohol in her breath. And, oh, she's like pulling the other siblings aside and telling them about sex and stuff. And a lot of this, I mean, not exactly that way, but they had a lot of concerns about how she was influencing us. So their response was just remove her entirely from the family. And that did not go over well. There's been a lot of really unresolved issues there in the family. And I feel like this isn't something I blame my parents on. I don't blame my siblings or anything like that. I see Mormonism as the issue here. Mormonism really focuses on family. Family is central to everything. Families can be together forever. And they omit the fact that there's like a dozen asterisks on that. You have to do everything just right, just this way, or else, no, your family can't be together forever. In fact, oftentimes they kind of separate families and cause a lot of discord, like don't let families come to weddings. And there's good doctrinal support for the idea of, oh, we shouldn't support children who left the church. We should kind of remove them from our lives. The whole love the sin or hate the sin thing. It's really hard to do both of those at the same time. If you're going to really hate the sin, you can't be shown as supporting a sibling who does things that you consider sinful in any way, shape, or form, or your children. You can't support them in any way or be shown as that. And that was kind of the perspective at the time, at least for my family. And it really was just a big issue. A lot of hurt feelings did not go over well. So that was when I was about 8 or 9. I was really young. I was getting the story from my parents, not really from my sister. It was just kind of like, oh, your sister went way off the rails. She's deceived by Satan. Don't listen to her. Don't contact her, sort of thing. And I was like, okay, took that at face value. Too young to think otherwise. Another 3 or 4 years later, though, my brother Michael started having some issues with the church as well. And these were maybe a bit farther back. And because he's much closer to me in age, I kind of had a much closer front seat to what was happening there. Essentially, the ward back then had a bunch of youth that were just ruthless bullies, and they chose him as the target for that. So he was the target of some really bad harassment. We ended up moving as a result. Kudos to my parents for doing that, but it caused a lot of problems. And generally speaking, he ended up becoming the scapegoat of the family. It's like, oh, you're the one who can't do anything right. I feel like a lot of the unresolved tension with my sister Janelle over her leaving the church ended up getting channeled into him because he was having some issues as well. And it just did not go over well. He ended up having a lot of like a rebellious phase. He turned to video games for coping. My parents view video games as the gateway drug for porn, and that's terrible. So like, playing video games in our house was like borderline, I don't know, rebellious sort of thing. So that was just like, they saw this as this gigantic issue. I remember so many arguments growing up between them, lots of yelling. I remember a point where my brother punching a hole through the wall. I remember my dad and my brother like wrestling full on the floor. I remember police getting called at one point. I remember when I was like 11 or 12, having to essentially step in and kind of de-escalate it, like telling my parents, no, just because you guys are yelling, you don't need to call the police on him. Like, you're escalating this. It's too much. There's a point where, you know, the whole like legal kidnapping thing. One day people came up and just took Michael away and he was gone. He went to some sort of like rehab program in Arizona. It was like this wilderness program. And most of the people going to that were like kids who were deeply troubled, like drug addicts, like people who were violent. And then my brother, and what was his crime? Like, he was rebellious and he played a lot of video games. Like, he didn't really belong there. But the funny thing about that is that that actually ended up being a very spiritual experience for him out there in the wilderness in Arizona. And I guess this was the beginning of the end for him for the church, because that spirituality that he experienced there was completely removed from Mormonism. It had nothing to do with the church. So as a result, he essentially had, I guess, reclaimed spirituality for himself outside of the religion and his parents, sort of thing. So I guess that was a very good thing for him. But here I was on the sidelines seeing all of this. And I don't mean to like air family dirty laundry here. My point here, I have a couple points here. One is that if you have family who's doubting the church or leaving, you can't disown them. It doesn't work. You will not bring them back that way. All that does is deepen the divide, make them even more alienated. It does not work. And for me on the sidelines, what I was seeing here was that if I was not completely towing the line, if I was not completely Orthodox, my life could end up in kind of tragedy sort of thing. Like, I view a lot of these things as deeply tragic in a way, and I don't blame anyone for it. There's no bad actors. I blame the church, really. It's kind of the structures that enable these sorts of things to happen. And I don't think it's just my story. I think there's plenty of people out there who have these sorts of really deep-seated family issues as a result of arguments that first arise out of Mormonism, doubts around it, not knowing how to address those issues. So I had got the message loud and clear. I cannot in any way be unorthodox in this family or else my parents can turn on me, sort of thing. And I really understand both sides here. Like, as I was saying, like, the Mormonism as a result of like fear and like as a form of protection and safety, and my dad's version of it being like, I want to like pass on this legacy and this way of life to my children. Like Mormonism is the vehicle to do that. But still, it's deeply tragic. I guess I had a small experience of this for myself as well growing up. So there was a point where I got caught watching porn. It was not anything too crazy. But my parents really turned on me. It was, I think, the only time I remember my dad getting close to tears. And he was essentially like, I've already lost two children. I'm not going to lose another sort of thing. And I was like, wow, like that's a lot to put on a kid. In the year or two that followed, my parents just did this complete 180 in the way that they treated me. So my dad, for example, I realized that every time he ever communicated with me, it fell into two categories. It was either logistics, like, hey, I will pick you up at this time sort of thing, or criticism, like, hey, you need to be doing this better, or like, why aren't you doing this sort of thing? And that went on for like years. And I remember I wrote a letter at this point to my parents basically saying like, hey, I get why like my two siblings have so many issues with you, because if you turned on them the way that I'm feeling right now, like makes perfect sense. It's completely justified. I never sent it to them. But as a result,
around what age were you when you wrote that, do you think?
Say it again.
Around what age were you when you wrote that?
Age 16.
Okay.
Yeah.
And you're in what city? In Danville or where were you?
Yeah, so we grew up in Danville, and then at age 8, we moved to Lafayette, which is like 20 minutes away. And the reason why we moved is because of the bullying that my brother was experiencing from the ward there.
Right, okay.
Yeah.
But it's all kind of Oaklandish area or Bay Area.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All East Bay.
Okay.
So as a result, I was kind of in this very unique position in the family where I kind of saw both sides. I could see what like my family who left the church were feeling and why they had these issues. And I could also, I was still very fully believing at this point. So I was kind of still on like the Mormon camp sort of thing. But I kind of like saw this, I had a front row seat to this divide in my family and the ways in which Mormonism was causing that sort of thing. So in some ways, I guess it may be able to be more of a peacekeeper, but it also gave me a lot more insight into Mormonism in general. Going back into how devout I was at this point, next to our house, there was this forest, and just no one goes up there. There was a fallen tree in there, and I would kind of joke to myself that that is the tree that fell in the forest that no one heard sort of thing, like just so isolated. And I found this tree up there that was just the perfect shape. It had two trunks, and right in between it made this perfect prayer altar. So I would go up there, and I would kind of do Enoch-type things. I'd just like go up there for hours at a time, just pray until I got an answer about something. And I would pretty much always get an answer. The way I look at this now is essentially, hey, if I commit to myself like, hey, I'm stuck in this forest until I get some sort of spiritual experience, then yeah, of course, my brain's going to fabricate it. But at the time, it was like a very spiritual thing. It was kind of very deep-seeding me into Mormonism itself. So I definitely view myself as a very spiritual person. Everyone in my family went to BYU. No exceptions. I guess my brother went to BYU Hawaii, still a BYU. There was never a doubt in my mind that I would go anywhere else. Why would I even consider it? It was kind of BYU is the option. That's where you go for school. So I went to BYU. I did a year there first before my mission. It was pretty uneventful, really. Great year. Had a good time. I guess if anything, it solidified my love for BYU. I think it's a great college, great academics, a lot of really good people there.
Were you in the dorms?
Yes, I was in Old Heritage just before they were bulldozing them down. So that was kind of fun.
So you made your own food in the kitchens and that whole deal?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Terrible cook. I burned peas once, boiling peas. I burned them, like set off the fire alarm, but I tried. But yeah, that was a really fun experience. After that, put in my mission papers. I got my call to Taiwan, Taipei, the Northern Mission.
What year around?
This is 2014. So I reported to the MTC in October of 2014. So
5 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah. And I remember at that time I went to the temple for guidance on what I would do with the interim period between college and going on my mission. And the answer that I got in the mission or in the temple was that I should devote 100% of my time to being the best missionary I can be. And I was like, okay, well, how am I going to use this time? And I was like, well, if I'm going to spend 2 years peddling the gospel, I want to be a professional at it. I want to know all the arguments. I want to know how people view the church. I want to know the arguments against it sort of thing. I had the mentality of like, we have the truth and nothing can harm it sort of thing. And I was very confident in that. Like, yes, we have the truth. I just need to go find the arguments to persuade everyone else that we have the truth. So in that interim period, I started researching. I was like, okay, I need to understand the people who criticize the church. Where do I find them? Went on to internet forums. I found the CES letter. I was like, great. Started going through that. I actually stopped like 2/3 of the way through because it was getting too emotionally charged. And I was like, I'm looking for facts here. I want to find the arguments and how to refute them, sort of thing. So I kept on moving on. I was going through all of this and coming up with apologetics against it. And I was very successful. I was coming up with very good arguments. So very good, relatively speaking, to combat all of these issues against the church. And I was like, see, look, we do have the truth. Nothing can harm it. And people would just get mad at me on the internet. I'd be like posting on forums and I'd just like, oh, the wicked take the truth to be hard sort of thing. I'm right. The changing point was about a month or two into this endeavor. I found a post about Alan Rock Waterman's pending excommunication. It's funny, I view them as the big three back then. So Kate Kelly, John Delaney, and Alan Rock Waterman were kind of like the big three figures that kind of got excommunicated that year or close to it. So I saw this and I was like, okay, I'm interested in how he's wrong. Pull up his blog, start reading through. And the big difference here was it was no longer a I'm outside of the church and I'm attacking it on truth claims. It was now a, I'm inside of the church and I'm attacking it on moral claims. What I was starting to realize was that I was looking to the church as a moral institution, as a place to find, like, basically a template for what is exemplary behavior, what is the best moral life to live. And I was starting to realize that, no, the church really is not very good on that track record. So things that were really disturbing to me at that time were things like, spending $2 billion on a mall? What's that? Like investing billions in stocks? I remember I figured out that buying my groceries at Walmart donates more to charity than paying tithing. And I was like, whoa, huge issue here. I was seeing the church as charitable and now I'm not really seeing it. And then a lot of things that they were really trying to hide, like hiding their finances. What are they doing? If they're hiding it, it seems like they're up to something. And then we learn like, oh, they have six-figure salaries. I was told small stipend. To me, that means the $150 a month that a missionary gets. It was very misleading.
You mean the general authorities getting mm-hmm. six-figure salaries?
Exactly. Yeah, all those sorts of things. And then I was starting to uncover kind of, I guess, the underbelly of Mormon culture. So like the culture of fear and shame and guilt, gossiping. Utah's one of the top 10 in the nation for opioid overdoses. That's a huge red flag. Suicide rates, especially for the youth, LGBT youth, are just sky high. And I was just starting to uncover all of this stuff. I was realizing all of these ways in which we'd really changed. Mormonism has just been a very fluid organization, and what it was at the Restoration is wildly different from what it is now. So that was kind of the breakthrough point for me where that started my faith transition and realizing, oh, the church isn't what I thought it was. I still believed, I still viewed the Restoration as divine, but it was like, well, maybe the church is in apostasy. I can't really trust the church as it is now as a moral exemplar. So I kind of had this very interesting middle phase there, whereas essentially, I guess you could call myself a snufferite. Like I read his book at one point. It was very interesting stuff, kind of the whole idea of the church and apostasy sort of thing. And that was kind of a stepping stone for me to kind of get through my faith transition because I was so in the church that I couldn't just go from in to out. It had to have some sort of middle ground there. This was at this point about a month before my mission was about to start. And I had the presence of mind to realize, oh, a mission might be an issue when I'm going through these things. So I reached out to my two siblings who left the church and I was like, hey, I'm having these doubts about the church. I still believe in God and the Restoration and stuff, but, I might have some issue on my mission. Can you guys support me, sort of thing? And they responded very positively. They were like, yeah, we don't really care what you believe and whatnot. Like, we're here for you. And that was really great. Then I went into the MTC. And part of this time was I was kind of testing the waters for how my parents would react to this. So I'd kind of like share little things with them. And it almost always ended up with them being really, really concerned about me. And the breaking point for that was in the MTC where I got an email from someone in my ward back home. And he basically told me like, hey, your mom is talking in church in such a way that it sounds like she's going to go to your future mission president and tell him what a bad missionary you are and like you have all these issues and like I want to give you a heads up, like you may have some trouble ahead of you sort of thing. And I was like, whoa, thanks for letting me know. Luckily, I think
how'd your parents know?
I was telling them little things, and especially when I got into the MTC itself, I was like, I'm going to have 2 years. They can barely contact me because of all the mission rules. I can say whatever I want because they can't do anything about it sort of thing. So I started being very more loose-lipped right around the MTC time.
As you wrote them home? As you wrote them or just talking to them?
Literally the day before entering the MTC, I was like, hey guys, I'm considering reincarnation. And they're like, wait, what? Sort of thing. And then my emails home in the MTC were extremely unorthodox. I was like saying everything that was going on with the missionaries. And if you know missionary culture, it's like, it's a bunch of 18-year-olds stuck in a room with nothing to do. They're going to talk about stuff that's not going to seem super holy on the outside. And the culture is, don't talk about that. Make your emails home very uplifting. And I was like, no, I do not care about that. I'm saying what I see here sort of thing. And that really concerned my parents and people back home.
And just to be clear, you read Denver Snuffer prior to your mission.
Yes.
That's crazy.
Yeah, isn't it?
Do you remember how you heard about the book?
Probably through Waterman. I think there was at least some connections between those two.
Okay. Wow. And so like, did that make you want to try and see Jesus?
Yes. I remember distinctly a point in the MTC where I was like, all right, I'm doing this. I'm going to get an angel sort of thing. And I was like down on like the floor, like praying for so long and nothing happened. But I'd like convince myself like this is going to happen sort of thing. Didn't. And that was kind of the mind space I was in. It was a very, very just really objectively an intriguing place to be mentally, because it was like you look at the scriptures and you realize there is so much leeway for how you interpret it if you don't have a prophet now telling you how to interpret it. So as soon as you remove that corner, that sort of interpreter, you can interpret the scriptures any way you want to. So I was kind of trying to figure out, okay, how do I want to interpret these? And you can go in so many different directions. So I was almost in a way coming up with my own personal Christian-esque religion for myself in that void. And kind of experimenting with it and seeing to what extent I could bounce it off of other people and see their responses and get feedback and kind of morph it as I go. So really fascinating on that front. So turns out that whole thing of my parents telling my mission president I'm a bad person, whatever, wasn't the case. Some sort of miscommunication, maybe misunderstood some gossip going around that my mom was spreading.
But you were kind of traumatized by the way they had treated your siblings. And so you just, it must have been emotionally scary for you to know that your parents could turn on you at any time.
Yes. So that was the final confirmation for me that nothing has changed. It will still be essentially tragedy for me if I try to go against them, if I'm not fully independent from them. So that was the point where I was like, oh, I need to stop talking to my parents about this sort of thing. Need to go radio silence on that front. And that is what it is. Also, another aspect of this was because I was kind of loose-lipped in the MTC, it put a target on my back for the entire mission as being the missionary that preaches false doctrine sort of thing. And I would occasionally have people come up to me and kind of like to the side be like, hey, you're the guy that's like into deep doctrine, right? And I was like, sure, okay, what is it sort of feel? and I could never shake that for the rest of my mission. It maybe caused some issues. It wasn't a huge deal, but it was kind of, I was branded that way now. I did some crazy stuff while I was in the MTC. I was just wanting to get everything I possibly could about the restoration at that point, read through anything I possibly could. So I somehow convinced my companion to go to the print center at the MTC, and I printed like 10 volumes of the Journal of Discourses in 4-point font, put them into all these little folders, just had this huge stack. And then I'd like fold them up, put them into my scriptures. And then during personal study time, it would look like I'm reading the scriptures, but actually I have this piece of paper of the Journal of Discourses. I was like going way deep on that. Once I got out to the mission field, I got little USB MP3 players, so tiny little things, really, really easy to hide. And then I downloaded as many podcasts as I possibly could. I listened to a lot of Mormon stories during this time, both before my mission and on my mission. One of the really big ones for me was Mormon Expression. The role that Mormon Expression played for me was he goes through topic by topic. So for me, it was essentially, I had this whole faith crisis where my big castle came toppling down. And now I'm like, okay, what am I going to rebuild? I have to look at every single stone and be like, is this something I want to incorporate into the new me? And that was a way to kind of look at every single stone of Mormonism and really examine it thoroughly and see, okay, here's the holes in the logic here. Here are the issues with this sort of thing. And I very slowly, methodically went through kind of every aspect of Mormonism by listening to these podcasts. And I would listen to them like really late at night when my companion had gone to bed, in the shower.
Like, did you have an iPhone? Did you have a...
Little USB MP3 player.
Okay.
Tiny little thing. Could plug it into the computer. It looked like a flash drive. So it was like, oh, it's just photos or something.
But it's got a little audio jack out.
Exactly.
And again, you downloaded those before you went to the MTC?
I didn't have the breadth of mind to do that, but I had some lenient enough companions initially in the field that they let me do that on P-Day.
So on P-Day, you would just be downloading MP3s, sticking them on your little flash drive.
Exactly.
And then sneakily listening to them. I wonder, because honestly, missionaries reach out to me all the time. And I wonder how in the world are they listening to Mormon Stories on their missions?
Well, nowadays they have smartphones, they have iPads, they have a lot more technology. So I'm imagining it's easier for us.
I would just think it's all blocked, but I guess people find ways around stuff.
So. Yeah. So the way I did it was I got two of those very small USB MP3 players. They looked exactly the same. So if someone saw one, they wouldn't know there's a second sort of thing. I got a bathroom bag with toiletries. At the very bottom of it, it was a black bag. At the bottom of it, there's a black sock. Inside the black sock, I stuffed that stuff into there.
Oh my God.
Bring it into the bathroom with me when I was like going to take a shower. I'd take one of them, plug it into the wall so it could charge, and then I could listen to the other while I was showering, and I'd have like 15 minutes there. And it was just like, no one could figure that out sort of thing. Well, maybe someone caught
it. That's pretty elaborate.
Yeah. The things you got to do on a mission in order to get like outside material in, because it's like there's six books that are approved that you can read, and like everything else is out of bounds. Another thing I did was I started this little notebook of notes. And what I'd do was, as I got reading material that I liked, I would find quotes and I would copy it by hand into this notebook until I had this notebook filled with these quotes from, non-correlated materials. And then that way, whenever it was like really on lockdown in the mission sort of thing, I could still be reading that and it looks like, oh, that's his scripture notes or something. But really, I'm reading other books that I'm not supposed to be. All of these tiny little things that was like, this was kind of how I got by. This is how I coped being a missionary when I'm unorthodox with all of these really stringent rules. So tons of podcasts. I was just methodically going through everything, kind of giving Mormonism and Christianity and believing in God my best shot this entire time. I was doing things like taking the idea of praying always to heart. And I would literally, like, my every other thought was turning into a prayer. And I like basically was like programming my mind to take that very literally, like those sorts of things. I was going all in on this. It was like, I really need an answer. I need to figure this out sort of thing. It was my life 24/7. I was a missionary by day and I was studying all this stuff by night sort of thing. Nothing else in my life. I was full in on this. The big turning point for me was, so I'd gotten on island in Taiwan. I had a great trainer. It was good stuff there. He left. I got my next companion. He was a former assistant to the president, AP. This guy was 110% obedient. Like literally, he would make up rules that didn't exist. Here's an example. We went out to eat one day. We walked into this little food place and he just froze at the door. And I was going to like get a table and stuff. I was like, hey, what's wrong? He's like, there's no men in here. We can't eat here. And I was like, we don't need a male to accompany us when we're in public. Like, that's ridiculous. But he was like, no, we need to have someone accompanying us. Everyone here is female right now.
Ooh,
I was like, that, okay, man.
He must have been really wrapped tight around the axle regarding women, because that's a pretty intense reaction.
Yeah, well, the entire mission field was that way. It was like, it felt like the church does not trust their missionaries in any way, shape, or form, which is why everything's on lockdown. Why, if we taught female investigators, we had to have some member who's a male present. And if I remember right, just before I left the mission field, they outright banned it. Like, males can only teach males, females only teach females. It was like, the level of distrust there was just, I don't know, it was a big red flag for me, because like, why don't they trust us sort of thing? Why do they need to put all these rules in? And on my side, I wasn't trusting the church either, because I'd seen all these ways in which they'd misrepresented their history, misrepresented what they do, their charitable actions. So it was just like a trust issue all around. another example I remember of this guy. So we'd go to internet cafes to do our emails. And internet cafes, you got a bunch of like young kids like playing games and stuff, and they'll swear and stuff at times. And my companion couldn't take that. There'd be times where we'd be sitting there emailing, someone would swear, and you just like stand up and look over and be like, don't say that word sort of thing. I was like, what the hell?
Like, okay. Raise the hand of the square, like Joseph Smith in Liberty Jail, casting out the evil.
Yeah. So he really made my life pretty hellish for, I only had him for 5 weeks, not even six. They moved that one transfer a little bit, but even for 5 weeks, it was so hard. I have a permanent floater in my right eye from like the stress and the sleep deprivation of that time. I like to think of it as like the souvenir of my faith transition. As far as I can tell, it's going to always be with me just from like the intense stress of that time. I remember I was so angry during that time, and I just had no way to express it. I didn't really have people I could talk to. I had to keep up appearances sort of feel. So I would like put it into my journal, and on P-Day, I could occasionally talk to maybe one of my siblings at home. And I just remember like just being so angry and just writing all this stuff like, oh, how dare the church do all this, these things, and like breaking apart families and like stealing people's money and whatever it is sort of thing. I was very angry and I had no way to express it. It finally culminated in one morning. So I was just so sleep deprived, so tired, so stressed out. It was personal study in the morning. I was reading something in the Book of Mormon so I could have something to share with my companion because he had to know exactly what I learned. I was reading about the spirit world and Alma, and I started kind of drifting off, daydreaming a little bit, and I started daydreaming about going to the top of our apartment building and jumping off so I could go to the spirit world. And then I kind of kicked back awake, and I was like, what just happened? Am I suicidal? Do I want to kill myself? I started like very seriously thinking through this. Is this something I want to do? And then personal study ended. Companionship study started. My companion turns to me and he's like, can you give me a priesthood blessing? The sun hasn't been out for several days and I'm feeling depressed. So I go over there. I put my hands on his head. I'm blessing him to have sunshine in his heart sort of thing. All the while thinking, do I want to kill myself? And that moment right there was when the floodgates opened sort of thing. That was the breaking point for me, because this whole time I basically devoted 24/7 to figuring out this whole God thing. Like, is there a God? How should I believe in him? How can I be the best person and follow him sort of thing? And what was the response? God essentially rubbing lemon juice in the wound sort of thing. Not only not going to help you, but like, I'm going to like mock you in this way sort of thing.
Making you give someone else a blessing when you needed help. Is that what you mean?
Exactly. It just felt so, the contrast between me wanting to kill myself and my companion getting support from me because the sun wasn't out. Just like this, that contrast just broke me in that moment. And it was like, in that moment for me, the feeling was I had to make a choice between survival or my belief in the church, one or the other. And at that point, I decided I'm choosing survival. I don't want to ever feel this way again. My first priority here is keeping myself away from that brink. And as such, I can't wait on God anymore. He isn't coming. I got to trust in myself. I got to take control of the situation sort of thing. So in that one just brief instant, the whole like, almost a year at this point. So this is now mid-2015 that this happened, came crashing down. And in an instant, I turned from being like a very devout, like Christian person trying to figure out belief in God to full-on agnostic. And I entered what I call survival mode, where it's essentially like, I am willing to do whatever it takes to keep myself surviving. And if that means I break what I consider to be moral laws, if I need to lie to people, if I need to misrepresent where I am, so be it. I need to keep myself alive. So that was a huge just threshold point for me. And very quickly after that, I was like, okay, well, what is my direction now? How do I know what I should be doing sort of thing? And luckily enough, I'd been collecting a lot of stuff throughout my mission at this point. So I had a book on Stoicism. I had a bunch of Buddhist proverbs and stuff. And I kind of went headfirst into those, kind of turning to other faiths to kind of get an understanding of like, what is a base philosophy to approach the world since the very core of my being has been destroyed? So I delved very much into that, and it was very helpful. As a result, I kind of consider myself a I guess a philosophical eclectic is maybe a way to put it. So I take to heart the Mormon idea of Mormons find truth wherever they find it, and they incorporate it into Mormonism. It doesn't matter where. You find little bits and pieces from everything, and you incorporate it into one great being. That is in Mormonism. Mormons themselves, I don't think we really follow that these days, but I've, going forward, that's kind of my philosophy and how I like to do things. So as a result, my own personal perspective on life and philosophies and whatnot end up taking little bits and pieces from Taoism, that's a big thing in Taiwan, Buddhism, Hinduism, Stoicism, Christianity, whatever Hinduism, I think I already mentioned that, whatever it is, I wanted to find the good things of it and distill it down into something that worked for me that was a coherent worldview. So that was kind of how I went forward. And then the big question there was, do I leave the mission? Because I don't believe anymore. There's nothing left for me here. I went into the mission thinking, oh, I'm still somewhere in the restoration umbrella. I just need to figure out where exactly sort of thing, and it's still valuable to be a missionary. And now it was like, I don't believe in any of this. So as a result, do I stay? Do I go? And about this point, Janelle started responding to my emails. She had been missing in action for a bit, and she was started kind of coaching me through this. And she was like, okay, your options here, you can continue to play the part, given just how badly my family has reacted in the past with these sorts of things. It's a very attractive option. You can go ahead, finish your mission, go back to BYU, have a good program there, get your degree, and then once all that's done, once you're finally free, then you can let people know, yeah, you don't believe anymore. And she was like, well, if you do this, though, I want to give you a warning. If you take that path, it's going to be extremely emotionally fraught, maybe emotionally damaging, and you're going to have to accept that sort of thing. And we talked through a lot of the other options. Like, she was like, okay, if you need to go home, like, I can support you. We can, like, help you get a life back there sort of thing. And I kind of was walking through what are all my options here. And what I essentially ended up realizing was that when it came to my goals for what I wanted in life, for my education, for independence, for all of that stuff, the quickest way to all of those goals was to stay in the mission, finish this up, go to BYU, finish that up, and just not tell anyone that I don't believe until all of that was finished. And at that point, I, after going through it all, deciding, yeah, that's the best path forward, I basically had to commit to myself, okay, I'm willing to take the emotional damage that comes as a result of that. I acknowledge the fact that being an ex-Mormon as a missionary is one of the hardest things anyone can possibly do. I wouldn't wish this on my worst enemies, sort of thing.
Talk about that for a second. Like, what's hard about, I mean, on face value, it seems impossible and excruciating to continue as a missionary when you no longer believe. Mm-hmm. Tell us what that's like emotionally and practically. How do you do it?
So the way I ended up approaching it was essentially, why not think of this as a job? Like, when it comes down to it, like, I'm getting benefits from this in my life in such a way that it's as if I were just working a job. So this is just what I do. It's my day job sort of thing. I don't need to be emotionally involved in it. But further than that.
So you compartmentalize and take the emotion out of it and just go through the motions intellectually and
yes,
physically.
Yes, to an extent. The other part of this was, you may recall, I talked about debate growing up. I was like, you know, this is a great exercise for having these conversations with people. So the way I ended up approaching missionary work going forward was kind of a, all right, I don't believe in this Mormonism thing at all, but I'm going to give you my best argument of it. I'm going to steel man the Mormon belief system to this person on the street, this random Taiwanese dude that I cornered sort of thing. And then it's like, I want to hear your rebuttals to this. Like, what is your worldview? How are you going to respond to this? I want to get... So I guess missionaries, they have this sort of, cultural imperialism. They go into these foreign countries basically saying, we have the superior religion, we have the superior culture, and we're going to give it to you guys, sort of thing. And I kind of reversed that. I was like, well, the one that I have kind of sucks. I'm trying to get away from it. What do you guys think? What is your culture? What is your belief? Let's reverse the tables here, sort of thing. So I was no longer the missionary. I was the investigator with the entire country of Taiwan as my teachers. And it was really, really just a fascinating experiment. I guess what I realized was that the sorts of mental models that these different countries and different ways of thinking use are so, just on a fundamental level, so different from each other. And as a result, most people do not really understand any other methods of looking at the world. And it was really eye-opening to be able to actually get outside of myself and really fully put myself into the shoes of someone else and how they think, how they believe, how they view the world. I think that's a really rare thing to have happen. How often is it that people have their entire base perspective on the world completely shattered to its core in front of their eyes and then restart from scratch? That's so rare. And in my opinion, that's a huge gift. How wonderful it is to be able to re-examine everything that makes your mind work and think on that level and then rebuild everything in a methodical, highly examined level, to the point that the end result is something that is fully yours, that you are the author of everything that you now believe at the end of that road, because you started with nothing. You destroyed everything and then you rebuilt from nothing. I think that's a really valuable experience. And as a result, I feel like extremely grateful to have had that experience, even though by far it was the most painful thing I've ever done in my life. I wouldn't wish a faith crisis on anyone, much less doing it on a mission, much less at BYU. It's just a terrible situation, but I valued it.
Okay. So it wasn't excruciating and psychologically damaging for you to finish. How much of your mission, how many months did you?
I had a year and a half at that point. So the majority of my mission was ahead of me as an agnostic.
So you spent a year and a half as a non-believing missionary. Mm-hmm. Did your companions ever get, you know, did they ever find out? Did you ever confide in them? Did you ever confide in your mission president? Any of that?
I confided in my trainer at one point that I was thinking that the church as it is might have gone astray, but that wasn't my final resting point of an agnostic, and I never told anyone that I was agnostic because I had been put into survival mode at that point. Everything was about survival, and telling people was just a risk. Why would I do that sort of thing?
Sure.
My mission president did pull me in at one point, and he was like, hey, I got an anonymous source that you're studying anti-Mormon literature sort of thing. Luckily, he's a great guy. He took it really well. But for the most part, no one knew, continued as normal. I had a couple companions who very much questioned my motives to be on a mission. They're like, it doesn't seem like you're doing the work for the right reasons sort of thing, which is completely true. But for the most part, I pretty much got by without anyone knowing, as if I was just a normal missionary, all the while just having a wildly different experience from everyone else. For them, it was like, this is solidifying my faith. And for me, this is the experience that is bringing me into something very different from what my original faith was. I think a lot of people look at the mission field in general and think, oh, that would be so hard because you can't watch movies, or, oh, that would be so hard because you can't have a girlfriend or whatever it is. And I mean, yeah, those might be kind of hard things, but from my perspective, here are the things that make a mission excruciating. Number one, chronic sleep deprivation. You get, at a maximum, if everything is perfect, 8 hours of sleep. Almost never does that actually happen. There's no way you can ever make up sleep on the weekends. And as a result, all missionaries are sleep deprived, chronically sleep deprived. They're like walking zombies. I remember I overheard a conversation where some of the missionaries were just kind of nonchalantly talking about them being, their vision was going bad because of sleep deprivation. They're just kind of joking about it. And I was like, okay, wait, what? Like, your vision's going bad because what? You're okay with this? I had a mission companion who just could not learn the language. And I think at least part of it was due to sleep deprivation. Another part was that he was on ADHD medication, and for whatever reason, the mission field denied that to him. Not completely, but they would give him like only a fourth of his medication, not the full amount he was supposed to get. And as a result, he just couldn't function. Like, learning Chinese is a really hard language to learn. And if you don't have mental faculties due to chronic sleep deprivation and not having the medication you need, you're just, you can't do anything. It's just a horrible experience. So that's the number one thing that I think makes missions just terrible. Number two is no alone time. You are stuck 24/7 with someone who's constantly watching over you and like making sure that you're doing the thing you're supposed to do. You're not breaking any of the rules sort of thing. And especially if you're more of an introverted type, that can really wear on you, especially if it's nonstop for 2 years. I don't know if I can throw around the word cult here. I guess that there's a lot of emotional charge there. If you look at the church itself, probably doesn't fit the definition of a cult. However, the mission field itself, it checks almost every single box of what the definition of a cult is. So a couple examples here. Removing your identity. So like removing your name, like giving you a number in concentration camps, for example, it's a very cult thing to do. In the mission field, you lose your first name. No one can call you by your first name anymore. You're now elder. Identical appearance. Everyone got to get the same haircut, the same dress. That's another cult tactic. Restricting heavily the things that you can read, the things you can see, listen to only be the approved things within the cult or within the organization. It checks another box. The obsession with getting new members checks another box. It's almost textbook definition of what a cult is. And I don't think we give enough attention to just how damaging and how harmful the mission field can be for these people. Almost every mission companion that I had on the mission was struggling with some level of depression, anxiety, extreme stress. It wears on people. And then after the fact, they've learned to contextualize the mission in a way that it's the best 2 years. And, oh, I learned so much. And in some ways, maybe it did because it reinforced their belief. They became essentially this martyr on a hill for their religion. And as a result, that solidifies their belief. And as a result, it's a very useful thing for them. Brainwashing tactics have a purpose in mind. So for example, the military, you can consider it to be a cult. It checks a lot of the boxes there. They use brainwashing techniques to make the military okay, or the soldiers okay with killing people. That is generally widely against what our human nature says we should do. But we essentially have this socially acceptable way of brainwashing people into being okay with killing other human beings for the sake of defense. Similar thing with the mission field. Now, I want to make it clear here that the mission field compared to other harmful organizations is not nearly as bad. Like Mormonism in general doesn't hold a candle to Scientology, to Jehovah's Witnesses, to a lot of the smaller cults, but they have a lot of the same telltale signs, especially in the mission field, of the techniques that those organizations use to control their membership. And that's really alarming to me. And especially going through it with an outsider perspective, despite being within the mission field, it was really clear to me, like, oh, this is brainwashing. Oh, these are control tactics. Oh, I'm in a cult sort of thing. Just really eye-opening experience.
And yet you say that you finished your 2 years kind of being grateful. Did I hear that right?
Yes, you did hear that right. And how am I grateful? I sometimes think of it along the lines of, like, if you talk to someone who's been in prison, they'll probably say, like, I'm so glad for that time I had in prison. Like, it wasn't necessarily a good experience, but one of the things that humans are really, really good at doing is contextualizing their experience to be something that was helpful to them. Something Mormons do all the time. They look at tiny little things in their lives and say, okay, this is the hand of God helping me, and this was all for a purpose in the end. We all do that to varying levels, and it's what we have to do. We have to construct a narrative for our life in a way that makes it all make sense. I don't think we can live with life without having some sort of context and meaning to it. So yeah, in that sense, I'm grateful for my mission. I think it was a good experience on a lot of levels. It's the hardest thing I ever did. But there were some good things there. I wouldn't have stayed if it was 100% bad. The way I thought about it was it's about 80% just needless suffering and about 20% really great experiences. I have some really good experiences of like camaraderie with other missionaries, meeting really unique people, like biking through these like lush tropical mountains with like monkeys in the trees, and then like discovering this abandoned like cemetery with like ancient Chinese inscriptions. And I was like, this is full on adventure right now. Like, I have a lot of those sorts of experiences. We got to do paintball at one point. It was really fun. So I had some really good experiences on my mission. Don't get me wrong, but it was in spite of the church, not because of the church.
Right. Yeah. And I'm surprised emotionally it didn't have its toll on you, because you start thinking about, wow, this is a year and a half. I could be getting on with my education. I could be dating girls. Mm. You know, I could be seeing fun movies or who knows what. Like, It's got to be a hard sacrifice.
Yeah, it's emotionally a really hard thing to go through, especially like having other people point out in the mission field, like, oh, what about this thing in church history? And what about this issue with the church? And you can't say anything because if you do, it kind of outs yourself, sort of thing. Having to stay silent, having to essentially misrepresent who you are as a person, that is emotionally damaging for sure. I'm still kind of picking up the pieces there. Like, how much was I affected as a result of this? I'm not so sure. Still figuring that out exactly. But I guess I was able to contextualize it in such a way that I felt like it minimized the damage. And I arranged my goals in such a way that it was the fastest way to what I wanted to do in life. And as a result, it wasn't damaging in that sense.
Okay.
Yeah, but my recommendation is, if you are doubting, do not go on a mission. It is a terrible place to be. And if you have no other choice, if you have to go on a mission and you are doubting, you need people on the outside who you can tell everything to, that you can be fully genuine with. That is the only way you can make it through, sort of thing. Otherwise, it can break you.
So Janelle, your sister, and maybe your brother were important resources for you.
Yes.
Good job, Janelle.
Critical support network. Also, surprisingly enough, I found another missionary in the MTC who also did not believe, who also finished his full 2 years. He was a bit more nuanced in his faith. So on my hand, I was viewing the church as a kind of morally damaging institution. For him, he was seeing it as, well, the church isn't true, but I still think it's a good institution. So I'm doing this for charitable reasons to be on the mission. But I talked with him a little bit. We were in different missions when we got out into the mission field, but that was also a support network for me.
Okay. And so not only did you decide to go ahead and finish your mission, but to go back to BYU as a non-believer.
Yes. And the funny thing about this is getting back to BYU, it was a breath of fresh air. It's like, this is a cakewalk in comparison to the mission field. This is paradise now. Like, BYU is great. Why are people complaining? But on the other hand, so I did finish my mission. I did come back. I went through that whole gauntlet, got back to BYU. And the thing that I first experienced was essentially urban isolation. It was like there's thousands of people around me, and it's like they're speaking a different language. I don't understand them anymore, sort of thing. Like, I don't know how to connect with these people anymore. I've changed the way I think on such a fundamental level. So it's a level of loneliness that is far deeper than anything else I've ever experienced, because it's not only like I don't have friends, but it's I don't understand people at all on any level. I'm not capable really of having a connection with anyone around me. And I lasted for a couple months, if that tops. I distracted myself. I built myself a desktop PC. I was going to the gym a bunch. That only lasted so long before I was like, I need people. I need people I can connect with, or else I'll go insane. So at that point, I started looking around. I was like, how do you find ex-Mormons when you're at BYU? Like, there's so many issues here, because if people know that you don't believe, you can get expelled for that. That's a huge thing over your head. So you have to be really careful. Who am I talking to about this? How do I find these other people? What I ended up doing was I found someone on an online internet forum who had at one point organized a BYU ex-Mormon meetup, a one-off thing. I reached out to him, and it was obvious that he was extremely like paranoid about me. It was like, this guy might be at the honor code office, sort of thing. So he was like, I need really solid proof. And luckily enough, I had some connections. I got a moderator of that internet forum to vouch for me, sort of thing. And then eventually he was like, okay, I guess I trust you enough. I don't do those meetups at all anymore. Those are done. But there's this other group I know about who meets at this time, at this place, sort of thing. Maybe you can check them out. I went the first week. It was at a coffee shop, and that was scandalous, like going into a coffee shop in Provo, sort of thing. So I was kind of like going around the side and kind of peeking in, sort of thing. Like, what if someone sees me? And the first time I just kind of walked by the building once or twice and then just walked home, and I was like, too much. I'm not willing to go in. The second time I found this guy, and he said, oh, they happened to meet in a different place this week. They aren't here, sort of thing. I tried to go to that other place, but they weren't there either. And I was like, second time failed again. Third time I went, finally found some people. And it was like two or three other people, really small group. But there were people that I could connect with, that I felt I could like share my story with, that I could It was not like they were speaking another language sort of thing. And that was just so important to me for my mental health, for making it through BYU. And just, it was night and day difference between going through BYU completely alone and going through BYU with other people in the same boat who knew that experience, who were going through it with you, that you could have that level of camaraderie with. So that was like a saving grace for me. And then in the next couple weeks, they started telling me, oh, I'm leaving. I'm moving to Salt Lake. Oh, I'm moving somewhere else. Everyone in the group, almost everyone in that group, left over the next 5-6 months. And I was kind of seeing them slowly leave. Like, this great thing that I'd found, my saving grace, was kind of fleeing before my very eyes. And I was like, this is a huge issue. I got to do something before I break, sort of thing. So before everyone left, I started talking with one of the guys, Ryan Harvey. I got his permission to say his name here. Shout out to you. We started talking like, okay, what are we going to do here? How are you going to make it through this experience? How are you going to graduate BYU? And we started thinking about maybe repurposing this group, maybe doing something different with it. And I think the threshold point for that was we were up on the hill underneath Y Mountain. We had some folding chairs kind of out in nature, looking out over the valley. We were sharing a word of wisdom, non-compliant substance together, and just kind of talking about our vision for the future and like where we were going. And kind of in that moment, we kind of consolidated this idea. Okay, we're going to take this group that's dying, that originally was not even specifically BYU. We're going to repurpose it. We're going to make this a support group for ex-Mormon BYU students going through the situation, and we're going to throw it online and start advertising online for this. So over the next couple weeks, we started coming up with like some documents like, okay, this is kind of a scary thing to do because there's this honor code. We could get expelled for this. How are we going to keep everyone safe? So we started lining out, how are we going to do this? How are we going to make sure this is the safest thing we could possibly do? We started throwing it out there, kind of advertising online, these ex-Mormon meetups sort of thing. And the crazy thing about it was the biggest pushback we got was not from Orthodox members. It was from the people who had left. They were like, what's wrong with you that you're still at BYU? You need to get out. Like, you're going to get people expelled doing this, and that's going to be on your hands, sort of thing. So tons of pushback, and I really was not expecting that. And at first, I was trying to argue with these people, and I realized it just wasn't going anywhere. And I was like, how do you deal with this? Like, I'm getting pressured from both sides here. We got the Orthodox members at BYU who are like, this is a school for the Orthodox Mormon members, sort of thing. Anyone else, if you don't believe, get out. And then you got the other side of the ex-Mormons who are like, it's not worth it, man. Transfer as soon as you can, sort of thing. And I'm here in the middle thinking, like, if I try to transfer, like, my relationship with my family is just going to turn tragic. And I'm not ready to face that yet, sort of thing. Like, I need to stay. And there's a lot of other reasons why ex-Mormon students decide to stay at BYU. A lot of very good reasons, very reasonable things to keep themselves at BYU. A lot of people, even if everyone transfers as soon as I possibly can, if you have your faith transition at BYU, you're going to have at least some time while you're at BYU as a non-believing student. What are the support networks for those people? Even if they're about to leave in a couple months, there's nothing there. Everyone's like, just get out, nothing else. So there's this huge void there. And it was like, I need this help. I need this support. So it was like, nothing else, we're going to start it, even if we're getting pushback from both sides. And luckily enough, there's just enough of a need there, enough people just desperately needed to not feel alone at BYU going through this experience, that we started getting to people to reach out. And by the time that the last person from that original group left the town, we had like 6, 7, 8 people, and it was well enough established that we could keep on going on our own. And from that point, it just kind of slowly grew as this very kind of undercover thing. Like, if you were connected to ex-Mormon resources, you could find it online, sort of thing. We had like vetting processes, so like we could ensure everyone who's here is not going to report us to the honor code office. Like, the fear, the paranoia, the stress about that risk there is so very real, because people have been expelled at BYU simply for not believing, not even like breaking the honor code on other sides of things. That has happened. It's not very common, but it happens. And when you have your education and basically all your life goals hanging over your head, it's just, it's a really, an emotionally traumatic place to be, and you need support when you're in that situation. So luckily, at least for myself, from a purely selfish standpoint, I finally was able to kind of get something that was solid enough that I felt like, okay, I'll have the support I need to make it through BYU. But what I was realizing was so few people had gotten into that group. There's so many more people out there. I've heard so many stories of people who lost their faith at BYU. It's much more common than you think. Everyone who has that experience thinks they're the only one. And then you go and you talk to people after the fact, and everyone's like, oh yeah, I lost my faith at BYU as well. Like, that's generally when people start coming to maturity with their own viewpoint, is in their college years. So it was like, there's literally hundreds of other people like us out there, and we need to reach out to them, sort of thing. So that was kind of what drove me through this. It was like, we got to help these other people. Like, we got to find the others, sort of thing. And it was like trying to figure out, how is it that with all of this pressure from all sides against us, how do we find these people? How do we get them the support that they need? So that was, I guess, my experience with the group at BYU. And it was my personal overall experience at BYU was, it was great. I loved my time at BYU.
What did you study? Business, right?
Business, MIS? Information systems.
Yeah.
Yes.
And they have a great program, right?
They do. I originally was accounting, and they're number three in the nation last I checked. I switched at the last minute. That was a big reason why I decided to stay. It was like, well, if I want to do accounting, this is like the best school to do it, and by far at the best value for your money. Why would I go anywhere else? It would just be worse outcome for more effort and sacrifice. Like, why do that? A very good reason to stay. And a lot of other people do that. Like, animation programs are really great. There's a lot of other good programs.
Industrial design. Mm-hmm. A lot of good programs at BYU.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. So I loved my experience at BYU. Great academic college. I felt like I learned a lot. I have a lot of ties to BYU. I remember, like, as a 7-8 year old going and like staying in Deseret Towers with like my older brothers who were like in the dorms. And like, I remember like the BYU candy store. And like, that was my favorite thing as a little kid, as we'd go visit. My family had ties to one of like the BYU organ teachers. I was able to like go into the BYU organ practice rooms and like do organ when I wanted to. It was kind of a little safe space. There's a lot, like the environment around the mountains, like beautiful area. Like, there's a lot of reasons why I really did love BYU. It was a great school and I wanted to stay. And it was just the big question there was like, how do I make this work from my standpoint, given my perspective, my viewpoints, my religion, or my, I guess, perspectives on religion, sort of thing. And I'm not the only one. This is a huge issue for a bunch of other people. And how do we kind of band together and make this work and get through together?
Yeah. So you left BYU kind of really grateful for the experience, it sounds like.
Yeah. I see no good reason to not be grateful for your life experiences. I think there's always a way to contextualize what you go through in a way that it's like, this was really great for me. But yeah, from my perspective, BYU was great. I had a great time there. And I felt like I was able to kind of get the full college experience to the extent that I wanted to have that on my terms. A lot of people were like, oh, well, you're going to miss like drinking culture at other schools and stuff, and you're going to miss all of those fun years. And I was like, you know what? To the extent that I value those sorts of things, I found ways to get that here. I don't feel like I'm missing out on anything. I don't have a fear of missing out here. And I get people who have that feeling, who feel like, oh, they really missed out by going to BYU. I personally did not have that feeling.
So the things you're not supposed to do typically at BYU, drink coffee or tea, drink alcohol, do any type of drugs. Mm-hmm. You're supposed to stay active in the church. You're supposed to keep the temple, you know, recommend, question kind of covenants. Mm-hmm. You're supposed to believe. And, you know, no sexual kind of activity. Mm-hmm. So I imagine, once you don't believe anymore, those rules can often be off the table, but then you've got to figure out how to hide, if you engage in any of that stuff, how to hide it from anyone that might see.
Yes.
So that
yes.
you might get in trouble.
And the thing about that is simply not believing is technically a breach of honor code. Like you can get indicted for not believing anymore sort of thing. So from the get-go, regardless, we've broken the honor code, just given our position. And from that point, it's kind of like, all right, is there anything else here really of that much value? Like I want to live my life in the way that I feel is going to be the most valuable for me and the people around me sort of thing. And if not having a beard is like an issue for me, like I don't feel all that much devotion to the honor code to adhere to that sort of feel. But regardless,
do you have to beat back feelings of dishonesty? Like I'm being dishonest, I'm lying, I'm hiding, or do you kind of say, well, it's an unjust set of rules, so I don't feel bad breaking them?
I've had a lot of issues with that, to be sure. My breaking point on my mission, my conclusion was that my mental health and my ability to make it through is more important than honesty. But that is definitely a very conflicting thing. Lots of moral gray area there for sure. And I've definitely had the feeling a lot of times after getting out of BYU, getting my diploma and moving on with my life, like how could I have been so, I guess, dishonest on so many levels? And I guess part of that is I didn't feel like the church deserved my honesty to them, considering they hadn't been honest to me. And then to the extent that with my relationships with other people around me, I wanted to be as genuine and as open as I possibly could, because I really just did not like the fact that I was essentially being, dishonest with the institution I was in. So I would try to make up with that in other places, which is another reason why having a support group was so important. There I could be fully genuine and myself sort of thing. And I kind of made up for that fact. But it's still, I think there's a dozen different ways you could approach that. I don't fault people at all for saying I'm going to be 100% above board in how I approach this sort of thing. There's just so many different equally justifiable ways to approach that situation. There's no one good way.
And you didn't try and tell your bishop what was going on. Mm-mm. Yeah.
Bishop's roulette is, I've heard enough horror stories of people getting expelled by their bishop for the smallest of things. I wasn't willing to risk it. One of the big things here was like, I had this experience of a mission behind me and all of this pain and suffering from that. And it was like, I've already put in so much. My tolerance for risk at this point is extremely low. Because if things get thrown off the rails and I like don't graduate and all of this becomes for naught, that sort of meaninglessness for all of that pain in my life, I don't think I would have been able to handle it very well. The whole thing around me already felt unjust enough to begin with. I didn't want to mess things up and make it feel even more unjust for myself. So I took no risks.
And if somebody said, "You, this is unethical, what you should have done is just resign from BYU, enrolled in another school, you did something unethical," what would you say to them?
I think that's completely justifiable to say that, and I take full responsibility for the fact that by many perspectives, the situation that ex-Mormon BYU students are in leads them to do a lot of things that would be considered unethical, and I guess you got to live with that. That's kind of the nature of the situation right now. What I would really hope is that BYU gives a way for people who have left the church to be authentic at BYU, to have a way to say, okay, I don't believe anymore. I still want to be here. Can I transition to non-LDS tuition? They don't have that right now. They pretend they do. Anyone who's ever tried to fill out that form has gone expelled or suspended or something.
Okay,
like
what's
that.
This form? It's a form.
I'm not the expert on this, but my understanding is that Free BYU in 2015 had the whole accreditation thing with BYU, and the response to that was, okay, we'll make this form where you can apply to move from normal LDS tuition to non-LDS tuition. You can stay here. And there's kind of like, you guys want to have that avenue to be genuine here at BYU. Here's something. But anyone who's tried to fill it out, I don't think anyone's ever been successful.
So you know people that filled that out and got expelled?
Directly, no.
Okay.
But my understanding is that that is what has happened.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So normally when we do things that are reasonably considered unethical by some standard, mm-hmm. I don't want to say use the word justify, but we find, you know, we find some way to reduce the cognitive dissonance mm-hmm. by feeling okay about it. Mm-hmm. You were really upfront just saying, yeah, it was unethical mm-hmm. from some points of view. Mm-hmm. How did you kind of rationalize it?
I mean, I could justify it if I want to. One of the things that I was taught growing up is that to be fearful of rationalizations, essentially kind of the Mormon view of this is like, if you try to rationalize your behavior, that's a way to kind of downplay the fact that you're sinning sort of thing, and then that'll lead you to sin more. And that to me is in itself a level of dishonesty with myself. And the issue to begin with was, I don't feel okay with this dishonesty that I'm having, so why pile more dishonesty on top of that by trying to rationalize it, if that makes sense?
Oh.
So I would rather be, to the extent that I feel capable in this situation, as honest as I possibly can be with myself and the people around me. And part of that is admitting that by many perspectives, basically lying about being a good Mormon is a very unethical thing to do.
Yeah. So but you surely had reasons like it's good for me or it'll benefit my career or it's cheap
yes.
or it'll avoid conflict with my parents. Like that's
yeah.
what.
I don't really see those as moral justifications. Those are more like I'm trying to get something out of this situation.
Yeah. But that's what it was, right? That's why you did it, right?
Yes. Yes. And another big part of this was after I had made it through the mission, I realized that I was in a very unique position. I have not met anyone else to date who served most, if not all of their mission as a fully, fully agnostic ex-Mormon. So given that unique experience, I felt like I was in a unique situation to be able to help other people. I saw just how much pain and suffering that was for me personally. And I was like, well, no one's addressing this need. Someone should do this. Who better to do it than someone who experienced it? So I guess that might be like a moral justification for doing what I did.
Do you feel like you were able to help people?
Yeah, I think so. I've so many people who have reached out to the group where it's like, I am suicidal right now. I'm considering taking my life. Can you help me sort of thing? It's just, it becomes almost commonplace at that point. I had, for example, one of the people in the group worked for various medical services. So he had access to an understanding of suicides on on-campus BYU housing. And he kind of went with his coworkers and kind of compiled, okay, how many suicides are we seeing here? We got the number together. We compared it to the average for the U.S. for that age group. It's about 30 times higher for on-campus BYU housing suicide rates than the national average. And, I mean, they don't publicize that, and they try to downplay that for good reasons. One is you got to protect the good name of the church sort of thing. That's maybe not a good reason. Another part is suicidal ideation. You don't want to talk about suicides on a very upfront level.
For contagion, suicide contagion.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah, so for a lot of reasons, they kind of try to push that under the rug, but it's a huge deal. I know people personally, multiple people who had roommates commit suicide at BYU. I know people who have attempted suicide and luckily did not go through with it or didn't succeed. It's a huge deal. People are suffering in that situation, especially LGBT people. There are people who not only are ex-Mormon and at BYU, but are also gay, bisexual, transgender, like to add insult on injury for how much, I guess, stigma is against them in that situation. Like, that's really hard. And there's a lot of people in that situation and how do they make it through? And for the most part at the moment, it's, they go to counseling, they get antidepressants, but, and it maybe helps a little bit, but for the most part, they're suffering, they're miserable, they're considering suicide sort of thing.
Did you guys come up with an average number of suicides a year at BYU Provo?
The numbers that I got were secondhand enough and not concrete enough to have an exact number. So take that with a huge grain of salt. It is not anything concrete to say that the suicide rates are 30 times higher. I think the point is there is an issue. There's a question for how severe the issue is, and it needs to be addressed.
Mm. Yeah. All right. Anything else you kind of want to say before we have our last interviewee up prior to the panel?
I guess one last thing, my perspective on this is I do not view anyone as bad actors in this situation. I don't think anyone is acting in a way that they believe is like, I'm going to go harm people sort of thing today. I'm going to make this non-orthodox student's life really hard. I don't blame anyone for that situation. I do blame the system. I think there's a lot of changes that can be made to how BYU operates, for how the church runs, for how our culture works, that could alleviate a lot of issues here. But I really don't want to be... One of the things that I really dislike, that I view as being one of the sources of so many problems in humanity in general, is us versus them mentalities. This idea that, oh, I'm in the in-group, we're the elevated people, we're better than these other people, they're the enemies. That sort of dichotomy causes so many issues between people. And I really do not want to ever be labeling people as you're an enemy, you're bad sort of thing. I think the solution for a lot of these problems is to remove that sort of stigma, that sort of accusations, and instead be like, here's a problem. It's not related to people themselves. It's not your fault. It's not my fault. Let's work together and come on common ground to solve it.
And so that's what you're hoping to do, or trying to do, or tried to do?
And if not me, I hope that we can, in general, as Mormons, do a better job with that. And I've seen a lot of really good trends with that. I think Sunstone's doing a really, really good job with that. I really like the fact that you, on Mormon Stories, kind of exist in this middle space, and you're connecting a lot of Mormons who otherwise would not be connecting with each other and fostering understanding between all these different forms. We like to think of Mormonism as this one version. It is the corporate version, the LDS church sort of thing. There's so many flavors, though. Even within that church, even within the orthodoxy of that church, there's so many dozens of reasons to believe, dozens of flavors of Mormonism. So we need to understand that. We need to realize there's just so much diversity within the Mormon heritage and the Mormon umbrella. And we don't need to stigmatize anyone within that umbrella simply because they believe differently from us. I'm really proud of my Mormon heritage. I think there's a lot of really good things that come from that culture. What I'm really hoping is that we can take the baby out of the bathwater and kind of remove the toxicity that I see so much of within the culture, while still retaining the heritage and the really good things about Mormonism that's made it thrive on so many levels against all odds in a lot of ways. And I'm really proud that that is where I came from. That is my heritage, my ancestry, and let's build on that.
So what's the website? We'll refer to it at the end, but just for people that are going to be listening to this first, what's the website?
Yeah. So I had my one group. Eventually it turned into two, then three, then four. We got from BYU to BYU Idaho to BYU Hawaii. All three now have support groups for non-Orthodox Mormons. And we combined them all together into one grouping with the BYU Survival Guide. So this is a website. You can go to byusurvivalguide.com, and it has a listing of a bunch of resources. We've compiled it over approximately a dozen authors at this point, and we're welcoming more contributors to it, of kind of a central repository of here are the things that can help you make it through the BYU experience as a non-Orthodox believer. So byusurvivalguide.com. And from there, you can find support groups, you can find resources, you can find whatever.
All right.
Yeah.
Well, Jared Brinton, thank you so much for joining us on Mormon Stories and being a part of this series.
Thank you so much. It's been a pleasure.
And Janelle, thanks for supporting your brother, sister of Jared, not brother of Jared, sister of Jared.
Yes.
we love you, Janelle. And I hope, Janelle, you're doing some counseling and therapy for post-Mormons.
Mm.
And if you are, let me know and I'll make sure and refer people to you.
That's our hope.
All right, so we'll be coming right back with one more final interview of a BYU student, former BYU student, and then we'll bring them all back for a four-person panel to discuss the survival guide in detail and how you can either find or create or join groups to get the support you need as a BYU student.
All right.
And we'll take some questions from the audience. We'll see. All right. Thanks, Jared. Thanks, everybody.
So
don't go away. Come right back for the next episode of Mormon Stories Podcast.